Okay, so what is an associator supposed to be? A title that invokes something pretty elementary, starting from the beginning. So I did that. But I also wanted to get to very recent and interesting stuff that's going on now. So during the hour, that will happen. It maybe will be a little exponential in speed. But I think likely everybody here will know what I'm going to say at the beginning. So I won't spend too much time over it. So let me just tell you what I'm going to do in the hour quickly, give an overview. First, I'll just remind you of multiple zeta values and then the associator, so the Drinkwell associator, the first one. Then from there, I'll give the general definition of what we usually call an associator and some properties and applications, and relations satisfied by the associator and consequences of those relations. And at that point, I want to... Everything I'll be saying has some relationship with genus zero. Maybe there are many ways to explain it. One can say the multiple zeta values are periods of genus zero moduli spaces, or it comes from the Golden-Dietkner group acting on gray groups, which are genes, which are high ones of genus zero moduli spaces. But anyway, it makes sense that there is geometry in here, and it is in genus zero. And so then I will use, I'll introduce recent work by Benjamin Enriquez in France, who moved the whole situation over to genus one. And so he created the elliptic associator, he defined certain elliptic multiple zeta values, and I'll show you the analogs that he has to the genus zero situation. So the whole idea of what an associator is suddenly becomes a bit faster, because once you move from genus zero to genus one, you know, you can see the whole future. And at the very end, I will look at what wasn't done in genus one that is known in genus zero. And at that point, okay, there's a little island in the middle of the talk where I'm going to talk about a kind of mode theory. So for those who don't like it, maybe this will convince you. And for those who don't know it, maybe it will even more convince you. And at the very end, that will be applied to something else. So the very end will be actual theorem, new theorem. So that's kind of the overview, and I'm going to start very, very gently by asking if you can even see this. Is that okay? To me, it looks a little small.
Is the radio or the push button on the screen?
I have no idea. I'm not like. Firstly, you could probably more or less see it, then you probably all know this by heart, right? So the first slide is just very. Okay, so I'm going to start talking about multiple zeta values. Multiple zeta values are these real numbers given by these powers, these infinite sums, which converge if the biggest index is big enough. They've been studied for a long time. They have many algebraic relations between them that are much studied, very interesting and beautiful. And in particular, you can multiply them. If you multiply two of them, you get a sum, which I'm going to show you now. So the very first five slides are very, very old, well-known stuff. Okay, so if you take your tuple k1, kr positive integers, you write down a sequence of zeros and ones with the right number of zeros between the ones, as is written there with the epsilons, and you integrate that thing. You integrate, and you get the multiple zeta value, you get it as an integral, which is really, in a word, why these numbers are periods. And in fact, the simplex that you're integrating over, you can, it's can be viewed as a region, as the famous associahedron on the genus zero moduli space, on the moduli space of genus zero curves with n marked points when we're in n. And this is extremely easy to integrate. You just start, if it's not going to converge unless you have to start with 1 minus p1 at the end. And then you expand that out as a series. And then you just keep expanding out as a series. And it comes to the series that we just added up. So it's really easy to prove this. But it's also very nice because it shows that you can multiply them. Because if you multiply two of these integrals, it's a product of two simplices that you're integrating over, the same kind of differential form, but over a product of two simplices, so you cut it all up into simplices. And that shows, here's an example, a specific example. If you multiply zeta two times itself, you write the product of simplices as sums, and you get these terms that show up there, and you get this identity for the product of zeta two times zeta two. You write it as a sum. So that already proves that the multiple zetas form a Q algebra. But there's a second way to multiply them. It's almost even more natural. We saw that they were, this is proof by this is proof by two. The first example shows how it works in general. So we saw that they all look like sums of stuff like this. When you multiply two sums like this, it's almost the same as when you multiply two simplices. You break it up. The only thing is you also have to pay attention to these terms where terms are equal. So you do that. And the result is, again, you write it as a sum of multiple set of values, except that it's not the same sum as before. So it's actually a completely different multiplication law. So generally, I think of the Q algebra of multiple zeta values is equipped with the previous multiplication, which is called the shuffle multiplication. And this is the second. This one forms algebraic relations between the multiple zeta values. Either way, you see that we have a Q algebra. So, did I not write down what the weight was? Okay, I'll tell you. I thought I did write that down. Okay. When we have a multiple zeta value indexed by k1, kr, the weight is the sum of the ki's, and the depth is the r. So all algebraic relations between these things, we can now write them as linear relations between these things, because you multiply two and it's a sum. So there are really only linear relations, and no linear relations have ever been found by anybody that makes zetas of different weights. So it's a natural conjecture that this algebra is weight-graded. But it's a very, very, very strong conjecture, because if it were true, then in fact you would know they're all transcendent. Because if any one of them were algebraic, you would take a minimal polynomial, then multiply it all out, and you get things of different weights adding up to make zero. So this is actually a super strong, way out of reach conjecture. However, okay, there are various things you can do about this. You can consider an algebra generated by symbols. Zeta, k1, kr are just symbols, they're indeterminates. With that multiplication law of the shuffle and with the whichever algebraic relations that you want, like this family or other relations, there are lots of other relations that find in these things. And study the structure of that. And assume it's graded, and just try to find the dimensions of the graded parts. You can look at one graded part at a time. So nothing stops you from letting Zn be the part that's generated by the weight n multi zetas. That's a vector space over Z. And you can look at the dimension, and Zagier long ago made this very famous dimension conjecture, which is deep and comes from a certain generating series of many reasons, which I'm not getting into. But we did hear in a previous talk about motivic multi zetas. So in a sense, motivic multi zetas are a little bit like what I just said. They're objects, they're things, which have certain properties and they satisfy certain relations, and then they surject down onto these multizetas. And these dimensions are known for the motivic multizeta value. You probably heard that in the previous talks by Brown. So at least it's known that this is an upper bound. So I'm just going to give you one last bit of notation in order to get to the point of associators, which is what I'm really aiming at. So we have two known commutative variables, x and y, and any word, any monomial in x and y is called convergent if it starts with x and ends with y, and you'll see why right away, because I just have this obvious bijection between the tuples and words like this. If they start in x and end in y, then the k1 is greater than or equal to 2, and I use this notation, and this is a real number, so that's why I call these convergent words. But here's what's nice. Even when I have a word that doesn't look like this, that isn't convergent, I have a regularization formula to let me define zeta for any word in terms of zeta for the convergent words. If you do this project, so SH is the shuffle product. So I think everyone here knows what the shuffle product is. So let me just say it quickly with my hands. If you have two words, so these are not commutative words, so it's a monomial and another monomial, and you permute the letters of the two in every possible way where the order of each one stays the same. So you permute them like this. And so it's exactly what happens if you take a deck of cards and break it in two and shuffle them and put the two halves in. Each half keeps its same order, but they're shuffled together. And you do this in every possible way and add them up. That's what the shuffle product of words is. And if you do this here, you come out with only convergent words. It's made on purpose to get rid of all the non-convergent words, come out with only convergent words. So this is defined as a linear combination of those. And there is the definition of the depth and the weight, which I should have put earlier. And now that we have a zeta of w for all w, we can define our first associator. So this is the associator. This is the original and the model of all associators, the Drinfeld associator. The coefficients are these real numbers. And w is all words of x and y. And it is a power series in the non-commutative variables x and y. And due to the definition of
so
the...
You shouldn't have the first term.
What?
You shouldn't have the first term, because 1 is in Q of x, y. It's the empty product.
Yeah, well...
When so you have it twice now.
This is not right. W in Q of x, y is obviously not what I mean. What I mean is W is a word. And by a word, I don't count the empty word.
Huh?
No. I didn't mean like...
That's like saying in a group you don't count the identity. The empty word is very much a word. And you just
okay.
Say Z of 1 is 1.
The way I wrote it here, it's like W is a polynomial. No, what I really mean is
like
the sum is over W
is
a non-empty word. What I should have done is I should have written W non-empty word.
But why don't you just leave it as it is and remove the 1?
Yeah, I could. I want to distress the 1.
One.
I actually want to distress the fact that it's a group-like polynomial, which is a theorem. This is not a trivial statement. And it depends very much on the fact of where the regularization here comes from, where W is not. There's a long, long story behind the formula for W. It is specifically a way of regularizing divergent multi-zeta values to make this thing actually be group-like. So I'll get to the fact that it's group-like a little lower down. Now I want to say other properties of it. The depth R part of it is just the part that has R-wise. Every monomial has R-wise exactly R. And you can get that as an iterated integral of this famous differential form. This is the KZB equation. Another way to get the Drinfeld associator is you have two different solutions of this equation with specific behavior when z tends to 0 or 1, and phi kz is the monodromy. So
what's g? You keep jumping up. I have no idea what g of z is.
This is
no,
this here.
It's,
yeah, but
the
this is the first occurrence of g of z. This is simply a differential equation.
But
I can
but I don't know what g of z is because it keeps jumping.
Yeah, but there was no g of g. I'm just giving you a differential equation here.
We
this is a differential equation. I know. I can only go up or down, I'm afraid.
But you can only jump half of the time.
I can only jump. However, here's a differential equation. G of z is something satisfying this differential equation. And in particular, there are two solutions, particular solutions of this differential equation that I can look at, which are g1 and g2. Zero, which simply are solutions of this differential equation, but that have specific behavior asymptotically. One when z tends to zero, it looks like this, and the other when z tends to one. So there are two specific solutions of this differential equation.
What is V?
V?
V is Z. In the right hand side, you have V.
Oh, V is
Z.
V is Z, sorry. Yeah, many different notations. Okay, this is simply another way. What I mean is the Drinfeld associator, it comes up in many situations and has many properties. Okay, so I'm giving a really kind of overview of all the things about the Drinfeld associator. So it is a monodromy of a differential equation. That's on this slide and on the previous slide. It can be written as iterated integrals of this differential form. Those are already two very important properties, typical. And sort of characteristic of associators. Okay, and here's more. These are again properties of this associator, but which can almost be taken as a definition, in fact. So the Drinfeld associator satisfies the associator relations. I will tell you why and where they're coming from and what they do below. Right now, I'm just giving them like straightforward. So this relation and this relation, these two relations, they're just this power series in x and y. Z is just minus x minus y. But this relation is special. What happens is, xij's, they generate the pure Bray group on 5 strands. So I have a power series here, so I can substitute variables into my power series. And then inside the group, I can multiply these two. Okay, so I have five different elements here of a pro-unipotent group. I multiply them together, and I get one. So each of these properties can be interpreted a little differently. They can be interpreted on the coefficients of this power series. The coefficients of the power series are zeta values, multiple zeta values. So every time I say, okay, I have this, I calculate this power series, and I pick a word, and I look at the coefficient of the word, and it's an algebraic expression in multiple zeta values, and it's equal to zero. So what this is giving you is a ton of algebraic relations on multiple zeta values, called also the associated relations on multiple zeta values. Oops, one. Okay, so all these properties of phi kz, of algebraic relations with multiple zeta values. Now, skip that because I haven't told you about the double shuffle yet. I just want to tell you what a general associator is, and then I'll talk about the double shuffle the next bit and come back. Okay, so what is an associator? Now that we know what the Drinfeld associator is, it gave rise to the general idea of what an associator is. So it's a power series in X and Y. It's group-like. It has no linear term. And it satisfies these same associator relations with just one little difference. We allow, instead of I pi, we can have any complex number. So you can have an associator is associated with a certain constant mu, which is twice the, for various reasons of normalization, it's twice the exponent that appears here, which actually you'll see why in a minute. Okay, so an associator is almost exactly the same thing as, it satisfies the same things as a Drinfeld associator, except with just the change that instead of I pi, you can have a more general number. Okay? And like the Drinfeld associator, all associators, they do certain very useful things. So, this is a key, really important property of associators. This is where, on the one hand, there's geometry. There's pi 1 of actual spaces. And on the other hand, we're working in pro-unipotent groups, which are, they have, you know, many properties similar to the topological groups, but they also behave very differently. And it's not always easy to go from one to the other. In fact, it's highly not trivial. And what the associators do is, you take this group, which is just the pro-unipotent version of the free group on two generators, really, which is like the pi 1 of p 1 minus 3 points. You multiply the 3 and you just get 1. But on the other hand, you take the graded Lie algebra, so this. This is the same thing in graded Lie algebra language. And you take the exponential of that and then you get this group. And both of these groups are legitimately, can be considered in their own way as pi 1 or pro-unipotent 1 or Lie or graded pi 1 of p 1 minus 3 points. And the associators, they give you an isomorphism one to the other. This is called a formality isomorphism. When the groups are isomorphic, which in many cases they're not, you have lots of geometric cases in which simply there is no isomorphism between these two groups. But in the case of F2, right, the free group on two generators, they are isomorphic, and every associator gives you an isomorphism. This is just the example for phi kz, but I could replace 2i pi by mu and phi kz by any phi. And this will always give you a formality isomorphism. So in order to prove this is an isomorphism, I have to prove that this times this is equal to 1. And to do that, you have to use that second relation on the associator, which was this one. Well, these two, both of these. These two together prove it. You don't need a third one to prove that. You just need these two to prove it. So this is one of the main properties of associator, which when you want to go to higher genus, if you want a higher genus associator, you're going to want to have this property, that it's a formality isomorphism on the pi 1. Okay, so every associator gives you a formality isomorphism, as you can see, unless the mu is equal to 0. I said you could take all mu and c. So you can also take mu equals 0, but then it doesn't give you a formality isomorphism, obviously, because this doesn't work. But it gives you something very good. If mu equals 0, you get an automorphism of this group given by this. And in this way, we have two different things. Firstly, this, the set of associators with mu equals zero, it forms a group, because you have these automorphisms and you simply compose them, and this is the multiplication that you get when you compose. Secondly, all the other ones from mu different from zero are a torsor, because this gives you an isomorphism from one to the other, and then you can compose it with the automorphism. So GT0 acts on all of these as a torsor. All of these basic properties of associators are things that one is going to want to keep when you move to higher genus. And now you might ask, well, what's that five cycle relation in the five squared ring root four? What's the point of that? And that ensures that you have something very similar. So to think that the free group of two generators is pi 1 of p1 minus p4, but it's also the pure sphere four strand ray group. So if you want to generalize it, you might immediately think, let's generalize the space to p1 minus 4 points, let's generalize the group from f2 to f3, but if you're Gotendieck, you say, let's generalize the space to the moduli space of genus 0 curves with 5 marked points, and then the pi 1 of that is the pure sphere braid on 5 strands. And so we would also like to have formality isomorphisms from exactly like these, except going from the 5-strand ray group to the graded Lie version of it. And not only does the 5-cycle relation on the associator ensure that you do get this, this is the theorem of Kono-Grünfeld, it extends to genus 0 with 5 marked points, but from then, they also show that, in fact, then it works for genus 0 and n marked points for any n. So any associator actually gives you formality isomorphisms for all the braid groups and towards their braided Lie versions. Another thing expressed by Gotendieck, the principle, it was the two-level principle. If you can go to from 4 to 5, which is geometrically going from dimension 1 to dimension 2, then you can go all the way. And that's exactly what happens here. So now I will talk about the double shuffle relations. We know that multiple zeta values satisfy a lot of relations. The only ones we looked at so far are the associated relations. This is just another bunch of relations, and it's a very big question who implies what and which implies which and which ones are known and so forth. So the first condition is this. Delta is just the standard coproduct. This condition simply means that the power series is group-like. It's exponential of a Lie series. This is directly related to the way I gave the formula for the zeta of W, the regularized zeta of W for the non-convergent words. In fact, there's a long path of wanting this to be true and figuring out how to regularize to make it true and ending up with that formula, not the other way, the way I gave it. Okay, so it's group-like. So the double shuffle relations are two families. The first one is these, which are also known as the shuffle relations, which I won't explain exactly why, but you shuffle words, you get the product of the world. Okay, anyway, it comes down to being exactly this. The second set of relations is a little more complicated. So first, you do this. You take your phi kz, and you just ignore all the words that don't end in y. You take don't end in y. You ignore all the words ending in x. You keep only the words ending in y. Then you multiply it on the left by this correction factor. And when you do that, you get the series called phi core corrected, and that also has a property. That's also group-like, but for a different coproduct. So you take your phi core, and you rewrite it in these variables. Every single word in phi core ends in y, so you can write it in these variables. These are just free non-commutative variables also. And then you define this new coproduct, and that's group-like under those. So it's group-like and a modified, it's group-like for this coproduct, and a modified version is group-like for that coproduct, and this is the double shuffle relations. And just like we did for associators, you can take ds lambda, or I should call ds mu, to be the same thing. Series with constant term 1, no linear term, forget that. It's true that mu is the coefficient of x, y, but I didn't say it before, it doesn't really matter. And they satisfy the double shuffle relations. Okay, so now I can go back to my conjectures, which I had placed too early. This is a very big conjecture. So again, the double shuffle relations, they give you algebraic relations on multi-zetas. And the big conjecture here is, do they generate all algebraic relations on multi-zetas? And the answer is, we really don't know. But we do know a lot. We know lots of relations between multi-datas, and we do not know if they come from double shuffle. But there's no reason to think that they don't. There's been a lot of dimension calculations which do ensure, in, you know, in reasonably small weights, that this is actually the case. And this is a much weaker conjecture. The exact same statement, but for motivic multi-zetas. Motivic multi-zetas are obviously going to be much easier to handle because they don't have all the transcendence problems, and we don't even know, you know, that an actual zeta value is not rational or some crazy thing. So this is, as far as what we could probably realistically do, a much more realistic conjecture. So the double shuffle relations, they're very powerful. Conjecturally, they are like the source of all possible relations. And we have two very, very good facts about this. So one is, just like we saw that GRT 0, when you have the mu equals 0, is a group, also this is a group. And multiplication is exactly the same. Although here, it's harder to do because you don't have an automatic interpretation as automorphisms. The other one just came from composing automorphisms. Here, you don't have any interpretation of this as automorphisms. This was a hard work by Racine, and it's very hard to understand why it's true, but I'm going to show you a different proof later on, which to me seems much more natural. But in any case, you do have this, and you have this amazing theorem, which is really surprising, which shows that if you satisfy the associated relations, then all you have to do is change y to minus y, and you actually satisfy the double shuffle relations. So in terms of the multiple zeta values, which is in the dual, that means that the double shuffle relations do imply, they subject down to the associated relation. So they do imply the associated relations. So that's good. In view of showing the double shuffle relations apply all relations, it's good to have the associated relations, which are an important family. Okay.
And that map's a group map.
That's a group map, absolutely, because they have the same multiplication, and so yeah, it's a group map. Okay. This is actually really, really interesting. So first, people studying this, actually people study the Lie versions. It's nicer to work with the Lie versions of these pro-uniform groups because they're greater than you can calculate dimensions and small weights and stuff like that, and seeing that all the dimensions were the same, and then calculating the small examples, this became visible. This was a conjecture for a long time, because you could see that they were practically the same polynomials. It's very, very mysterious, and Fourier discovered this, but of course one conjectures that they're isomorphic, but it's hard to prove. And the way he proved this was using double polylogs. Double polylogs are like a key point relating associators and double shuffle also. However, he himself is very unhappy with his own theorem because he simply couldn't parlay it into an isomorphism. And now, right now, I mean, I saw him a month ago, and he and Enriquez are trying to work on a new proof of this, but not new. So Deligne and Terrasoma had a preprint claiming this result a long time ago that was sort of semi-written and very hard to understand. But they're looking at it deeply because they claim that there could be maybe some key ideas in there to reprove this theorem, and then maybe it will be stronger and give an isomorphism. The isomorphism is elusive. It's like it's mysterious, and it would be really, really great if somebody could get it. Okay, so now we get to the fun stuff. So this is just a little island. So forget everything for 4 slides, and then we'll get back to the elliptic thing. But the reason I'm doing this is because it's a tool that I'm going to use a lot in describing the elliptic thing. So the first couple of slides are totally trivial. And I'm going to use the way a column presents molds. So for a column, mold is just a family indexed by R, where it's a function of R commutative variables. But let's be very clear for ourselves. And just we're going to have rational functions over Q. These are not the only modes that Ekai looks at in the whole generalized theory of multi-zeta values. He doesn't only look at rational functions over Q. But for today, for this context, that's all we need. So it's just a family of rational functions over Q. So P0 is just a constant, and these are all just rational functions. So if this is the constant term, R is the space of modes with constant term 0. I say space because you add them in an obvious way and multiply them by scalar in the obvious way. And Gary is the set of modes with constant term 1. And here's an operator on moles that's just a little variable change, okay? Don should recognize this because it's what's called sharp in various articles based on the Ihara Kaneko Zenge article. This is a linear transformation with Zenge by matrix. And the Swappe they call A sharp. So it's something that's not discovered only by Tech. Okay, now here's how you can make this gallery into a group. You multiply this way. This is the multiplication formula. And now I'll show you a very interesting thing. It's like just a tiny thing, but it becomes a big thing in Akkad's theory. So consider power series in X and Y with constant term 1 that are in the kernel of this derivation. So by Lazar elimination, all such power series can be written as power series in these variables. This is just a standard Voronoi thing about the algebras. And these are free variables. So your power series, you can really write as a power series in the CI. And now you map it to modes by taking this. Each monomial, this is of depth R, it maps to this depth R monomial. So you take your power series, you cut it into pieces of depth R. Depth is just the number of terms in the monomial. Each part, you map it over to a mold this way, extending linearly. And so you get a mold. Each depth R part of your power series, it gives you the R part of the mold. And you get a polynomial mold. So in fact, this is an isomorphism onto polynomial valued molds. If you're wondering what polynomial valued molds are or what they mean, this is just a direct translation. Polynomial valued molds can be translated back and forth directly into power series. Any group like power series is like this. It can be written this way. So everything we'll ever see is in this situation. So I'm going to do something a little abusive and talk about certain power series or their molds using the same notation, going back and forth by this way. So this, if you look at it, it's nothing but normal non-commutative power series multiplication, AB. If A and B are two power series, this is just the concatenation, I mean the multiplication of non-commutative power series, translated into molds. But the cute thing, and this is very Akkad-like, this is almost trivial, is this is true for all molds. It works for power series, but it works for all molds. And in fact, everything that we do in this whole art of working with power series to study multiple theta values, the Ihara bracket and the twisted Magnus product and that product that we saw from GR to zero, everything has been translated to molds by Akkad, but giving formulas that work for all molds, also the denominators, and not just polynomial molds. So we'll see why that's useful in a minute. Okay, now I'll just give you the double shuffle, the translation of double shuffle. If a power series satisfies double shuffle, then this is what the mold satisfies. Oops. So you can just believe it's really not hard to prove this stuff. The first double shuffle relation of a power series is just of being group-like. It's expressed this way. And it's called symmetral in his notation. So SP is a function of U and UR. I can make any variable change, any variable substitution. So I shuffle these two sequences, so what I get here is a word W, which is just a permutation of these letters. And I substitute that into P. And I add them all up, and I get the product of the two. And that's the case, if and only if. If P is a polynomial mold, this is the case, if and only if it comes from a group-like power series. But if it's a general mold, it just is what it is. It's symmetrical. It's just an extended property. And here's the exact same thing. I haven't written it completely because it's a little long. Oh, my God. Well, I'm sorry. I have to cut it in the middle because I don't have any choice. This is a little more complicated, but it's very elementary to write down. It's just a little more annoying to write down. You have a property, a mold, where you take the Stuffel relations. Okay, I won't get into it in complete detail. I'll just give you the example for 2. This is the Stuffel relation in depth 2. This is the symmetrality property for a mold, okay? So where you have these two, you just add up the mold. But for a term like this, you get two terms. You get a pair of terms, one with the first and one with the second. Okay, this generalizes to every R very easily. It's a little bit of a pain to write down. But it's a simple relationship on molds, which has the following property. If the mold is polynomial, coming from a power series, then it satisfies this, if and only if the power series satisfies the second double shuffle relation. So it's called symmetry.
So if these were power series, it's just the usual power series formulation of the second
Yeah.
Shuffle.
Yeah, yeah.
This is formed, it's very
this is nothing but the reformulation of double shuffle in community variables. So this is something that was done a long time ago and is well understood. But it's useful to reformulate some of these things in terms of community variables for many reasons. Okay, now I want to have a very small digression. I mentioned this theorem that it's hard to prove that the nice multiplication of GRT0 also works for DS0, but it's really hard to prove. So I just want to show you one theorem of Ekal, and that you get this theorem as an easy corollary, and I'm going to use it again at the end of the talk. So I want to show you Ekal's remarkable untwisting theorem. This is an extraordinary theorem full of potential, which I've used, but I think it's got a lot more use that can still come out of it. So, did I say the Gary multiplication? Yeah. So just as we saw that he had a multiplication that extends the ordinary multiplication of non-commutative power series, he calls this Gary the multiplication that extends the one that we saw before, to all moles. And he has an explicit formula for it. So, under this Gary multiplication, the Gary moles become a group, and you can take the inverse. So I didn't know what notation to use for the Gary inverse of peaks. I can't use peaks in minus one. So Q and P are inverses for the Gary multiplication. So what I'm doing here is I'm conjugating A, right? This is just the adjoint action for Gary by an old P. I'm simply conjugating A by P, but all for the Gary multiplication. So if you're used to thinking of the power series and the twisted Magnus multiplication, that's exactly what's going on here when A and P are power series. Except this is completely general, and in fact we're going to use it when they're not power series. So here's the theorem. There's a very special mold P. If anybody's ever read any account, it's the mold that he calls pi. And it has this property. If you take a mold which has the double shuffle property, so it's symmetrical and its swap is symmetrical, that's just the double shuffle. That is, if A is a power series, if A is polynomial, it's literally a double shuffle power series. But even if A is not polynomial, we still call it double shuffle. And you do this. You do the adjoint action. You conjugate it by this special mold. It stays symmetrical, but its swap now becomes symmetrical. It untwists the second shuffle. Makes it, again, like the first shuffle. So you get something that's much simpler. It's still a double family, but it's the easy relation both sides. Okay, I'm just going to say a quick word about this. I won't define the mold P, but it's closely related to the Bernoulli function. And this is kind of key to why it works, for untwisting the complicated symmetry to make a simple one. This symmetry here, this is essentially the linearized version, the graded version of this one, symmetrical symmetrial. If you go to the Lie algebra situation, and then you take the graded, what you get is this symmetry. So it really changes the symmetry to the linearized symmetry. And in fact, this is a very general property of this mold of Ekal. It's not only true in this situation. It tends to untwist symmetries, making them into symmetries of the associated graded. Okay. Now, what's nice about this is that symmetrical and symmetrical is like group-like and group-like. It's much easier to work with. In particular, it's easy to show this. You take all molds in Gary that are symmetrical with symmetrical swap. The slash means symmetrical and the swap is symmetrical. And just this tiny property that they're even functions in depth one. So they're even functions of one variable. And you show it's a group. And that's easy. It's like really elementary half-page proof. Then Ekal's theorem shows that if you just conjugate this group by this mold, it becomes this. But we're inside a big group here, so this is a group too, right? We just took a subgroup of Gary and we conjugated it by lambda. So this is also a group. But polynomial molds form a subgroup. It's easy to see that the Gary multiplication keeps polynomials. So you could just intersect this subgroup with a polynomial subgroup. So this is a subgroup, and this is exactly double shuffle. That's what it is. Polynomial molds are just power series. Symmetrical is just double shuffle. This thing here is just isomorphic to that. Okay? So the untwisting theorem of Ekal just gives you a very natural, simple way to understand why this thing is a group. So that was an interlude, but I'm going to use that. I'm going to use it in two ways. I'm going to use the commutative variables a lot, and I'm going to use the key theorem at the end. So back to associators, but now I'm in the world of genus 1. And I'm going to just tell you some work done by Benjamin Henriquez. He's the kind of the sole author of the genus 1 associator theory, but on the other hand, the work that he did ended up being very closely related to a lot of work done by other people, in particular Heinen Matsumoto's work on the category of mixed elliptic motifs, and Ikan also in studying the double shuffle, double shuffle. So there are three things going on. There's Enriquez, elliptic associator. Heinen Matsumoto, Brown now also, elliptic, mixed elliptic motifs, and Ikan. And these things are all very, very closely related, and it's kind of the tip of the iceberg, that's what I'm showing you here. Oops, but it's still pretty striking. So, I'm just going to tell you how he defines it, because I have to kind of cut to the chase. So, here is a function, which is probably very familiar to everyone. You take an iterated integral over the usual simplex of this function, and you define a thing, you define a mold. What you have to do is you're defining a mold. Let me just say, for each R you do it. And so what you've got here is a mold. You have one for A and one for B. Here the difference being that you go from 0 to 1 or 0 to tau. I'm going to talk about A much more than B. Okay? So, let AT be the mold defined by multiplying by U1 UR. Then it's group-like polynomial mold. Group-like means symmetral, as we said before. Okay, so it's easy to see that this is the only denominator when you do the integration. But it's nice to multiply by it because I now have a polynomial mold, which means I have to have a power series. I'm just going to write A tau also for the power series, a group-like power series, okay? B of tau is also a group-like power series. Okay, remember, this is the way we go back and forth from power series to molds. Okay, so here's the definition. This is the elliptic associator, and very soon I'm going to tell you why it's the elliptic associator and in what way it has all the good associator properties. So when we have the Drinfeld associator, we take the coefficients, and those are multi-zeta values. Here, Enriquez defines elliptic analogs of multi-zeta values to be the coefficients of A of tau together with 2 pi I tau for certain reasons, not very different from why we add 2 pi I to multi-zeta values sometimes. You can also add the coefficients of B tau, but it ends up that you're not adding anything. They're all already there. And this is what we call the Q algebra generated by these elements. Why is it a Q algebra? Because A of tau is group-like, exactly the same way as that gives the multiplication on multi-zeta values, because phi KZ is group-like. So let me just talk for a minute about this algebra. Oops. Okay, we're going to look at the Bernoulli function again here. So I write Li AB for the free algebra on 2 generators, but the reason I don't write Li XY is because this one has got to be identified in our minds with the pi 1 of the 1 punctured torus. And Li of XY is the pi 1 of P1 minus 3 points. And in fact, when you take a sphere minus 3 points and you take 2 of those points and you join them, you get a 1 punctured torus. That gives you a natural map from the pi 1 of P1 minus 3 points into the pi 1 of the 1 punctured torus. And then when you use the formality isorevidence to move it all into the pluripotent world, you get a map from Li XY into Li AB, and oops, this is that map. The X, Y, and minus X minus Y, they go to these three elements. So this is a very special subalgebra of Li AB, which is the genus 1 part in the pluripotent world. Now, consider these two power series here. So phi KZ comes up, you can see, and it's e to the 2 pi t 0, 1. And they're almost identical, except here you've got, this is a conjugation, but this one is not a conjugation. They're just power series. They're group-like power series in XBAB with coefficients that are here. And what Enriquez showed is that the elliptic associator is obtained from these two power series by a certain automorphism, G tau. G tau is an automorphism of this group. And the coefficients are in the space of iterated integrals of Eisenstein series. So I'm not saying much about this at all, but there's a whole lot of joint work that we did with Mies Matthes, who's still here, I'm happy to say, who will probably, hopefully later, give a talk exploring more of this, more of the details of this especially. Okay, so what does that tell us? A of tau and B of tau are just a certain automorphism with good properties applied to these two power series that we just saw. These two power series, their coefficients are just multiple theta values, the usual values. So what that tells us is that if we take the coefficients of A of tau, we're going to get a bunch of mixtures of the coefficients of G of tau, which are here, and the multiple theta values, the usual ones. And in fact, okay, this is a little remark for Dick, or anyone else who likes UGL. It's inside UGL, for those who know it, inside of mice, doesn't matter. But the algebra, you can see that the algebra is generated by algebraic expressions in the coefficients of G of tau, the coefficients of A. And it turns out the algebra is the whole thing. It's literally isomorphic to the tensor product of multiple zeta values with 2 pi I and the coefficients of GT, a subspace of the iterated integrals of Eisenstein series. So that tells you that the algebra of elliptic multizetas looks like this. It falls naturally into two parts. And this corresponds very closely to the look of the fundamental Lie algebra of the mixed elliptic modals, which also falls naturally into two parts, one of which is basically Lie pi 1 of mixed A modals, which is the free thing with one generator in each direct, and the other, which is this UGL. So this shows that we're very closely related to what's going on with mixed elliptic modals. Okay, now I want to tell you, why is A tau, B of tau an associator? What does it even mean to be an associator when you're in GS1? So here's all the good things about A of tau and B of tau. Firstly, we saw that the Drinfeld associator came from a differential equation. And without going into any details, you have an exactly analogous differential equation in genus 1 based on the function that we just saw, the Kornicker function, and this arises the same way. Secondly, we saw that phi k z was the iterated integral of this form, or the depth r part was the rth iterated integral of this form. Exactly the same thing is true for a of tau. We just saw that, or what is the definition, that it arises from the iterated integral of this form. Thirdly, the Drinfeld associator, we saw that it gave a formality isomorphism from this group to the graded version. This guy gives an isomorphism in genus 1. I can't do any better than this, I'm sorry. This is just the pi 1 of torus with one point, right? And here's what it looks like in its graded Lie version. So it looks like this. And A of tau, B of tau gives an isomorphism one to the other, and the isomorphism is just this very simple thing. Either the A goes to A of tau, either the B goes to B of tau. So it hands you formality isomorphisms, just like phi kz. Then you have this. This is something I said before. You have a formality isomorphism which extends to one of the pure five-strand ring group. The same thing happens here. We have a formality isomorphism. It looks like it's on the pi 1 of the 1's punctured torus, just like F2 looks like the pi 1 of P1 minus 3 points. But in fact, you can also interpret it as braids on the 1's punctured torus, because the pi 1 equals the genus 1 braid group when you have one puncture. But the proper generalization here is, it doesn't generalize to... Okay, let me say what the proper generalization is. When you go from the 4-strand braid group to the 5-strand braid group in genus 1, you go from the 1-puncture braid to the 1-strand braids on the torus of 1 puncture to the 2-strand braids on the torus of 1 puncture. And this extends also to that. So you're going from genus 1 to genus from dimension 1 to dimension 2, exactly as in the case of genus 0. And the last thing is, why did I say we can extend to the five-strand braid group? Because it was ensured by these associator relations, and in particular that entagon relation. Well, you have similar associator relations on A of tau, B of tau, that come from the fact that you go to the two-dimensional braid group here. They're really complicated, I won't write them down, but the same kind of deeply analogous. Okay. But there's something missing, and this is the last part of my talk, so this is pretty much the end. There's one thing missing, that we have for 5KZ is double shuffle. Where's double shuffle? Double shuffle would give us a bunch of double shuffle degradations between elliptic multiples and the values that we really wanted. And then we could go and make an injector that they generate ovulations. That part of the theory is completely absent from what Enriquez did. So I want to talk about that to finish the talk. It's the last thing. So first let me talk about elliptic multiple zeta values. And just to be simple, I'm going to work mod 2i pi from now on. I think I'm going to have two or three more slides. And in all of them, I'm going to use the same notation as before, but everything is mod 2i pi. So phi kz is mod 2i pi and a of tau, everything. Because a lot of things are easier to prove also for standard multi-zeta values, it's often easier just to work mod zeta of 2. So I put a bar, okay, for this, the elliptic multi-zetas. Okay, so there's an ambiguity in language where people often say multiple zeta values, and they mean zeta of k1, kr. Or they say the algebra of multiple zeta values, and they mean any element of the algebra, not a specific multiple zeta value. So is a multiple zeta value one zeta k1 kr, or is it an element of that algebra? So there's something similar going on here. I say the algebra of elliptic multiple zeta values. But I also want to specify a set of generators that are interesting and study algebraic relations between them, which is what I'm going to do now. And what's really interesting is that the generators are going to spring from phi kz in a very natural way. So remember I call special mode p. Let psi be the conjugation of phi kz by p. So we know that phi kz is double shuffle, so we know that conjugating it by this will untwist it. They give me something that's double shuffle with a good shuffle on both sides, so symmetral. So this is a symmetral mode, like a linearized double shuffle mode. However, it's not a polynomial, it's not a power series, I can't study it as a power series. But I do master the denominators, and I'll tell you how to fix the denominators. It's really not that complicated. For any mode, you have two simple operators. Dar multiplies it by this. We already saw that earlier. And du, it's all Eta's notation, da, du, de, di. He's writing two vowels, multiplies it by the sum. So here's a map. Q, so you take P, you take its inverse under Gauri, that's Q. You take Q inverse, the normal inverse for normal multiplication. And you multiply it by dur Q, and you dar that, and okay. You define this, delta star. Believe me, it's a very natural thing to do. I know it looks crazy. But I'm showing it too explicitly because it's simple. At least it's simple. And it's also very natural, although I have no time to explain why. But anyway, this nice thing happens. And it's not crazy. It's for a very, very good and natural reason. Now you get something polynomial valued, which means this guy is just a power series of A and B. And it's not symmetral, but very close. If you just undo this rather simple map, you get something symmetral. Okay, so that's E. And let's just do with E the same thing that we did with A and B before. We apply the automorphism G tau. And we have this theorem. You have a unique automorphism of this group. This is the completed group. So it's X plus AB completed. Such that this maps to E, and it fixes that. And then, look, A and B, they come out naturally as the images of these two other elements. Once I tell you that something, I tell you who it is on A and that it fixes AB, I'm done. It's completely determined. So this just, this I don't need it in the definition. This is just a consequence, okay? And if I had G of tau, well, G of tau has every possible nice property you could possibly think of. It doesn't change any of these symmetries. I just compose it and I get this. So E of tau determines these two elements. It determines the elliptic associator completely. To me, this is the real key guy. The coefficients just, they generate. If you take all the coefficients of E of tau, again, we saw that they're mixtures of coefficients of G of tau with multiple zeta values, and you get everything. It fills up the whole space. So you can take these as your elliptic multiple zeta values that are a good set of generators for the algebra of elliptic multiple zeta values. So I call it the elliptic generating series. It's a little different from the associator. In the case of usual MZVs, the generating series and the associator are the same object, FIKZ. Whereas here, But these three are like a triple. They go together as a triple, really, because they all come from this one homomorphism. And the coefficients are what I call elliptic multiple zeta values. And now we can say what elliptic double shuffle is. We say any power series satisfies elliptic double shuffle if it's of the form delta star G, where G satisfies this linearized double shuffle, symmetrical with symmetrical swap. So G does not have to be a power series. It doesn't matter. If we have F as a power series, we can make it into a mold, and we write delta star G, and G may not be a power series. It doesn't matter. As long as G is symmetrical, symmetrical, we say that this power series satisfies elliptic double shuffle. So it's just like linearized double shuffle, but transported by a rather simple morphism. And the elliptic generating series does it, because it's defined to, well, E is defined like this. Psi, we saw that it was the conjugation of phi by Yekalla's untwisting theorem. This untwists if psi is just symmetrical, symmetrical. And G of tau satisfies in respect to everything. So E of tau satisfies the elliptic double shuffle relations, which means that its coefficients, which are elliptic multiple zeta values, satisfy the specific family of algebraic relations that look very much not really like double shuffle, but like linearized double shuffle. Okay, these are my last two remarks. You might wonder what kind of double shuffle relations we would get on A of tau. So the answer is, because A of tau is obtained by from E of tau as a certain automorphism acting on T01, you can translate it over and get a bunch of relations here, which to me are less charming. But they have been studied by Niels Matthes, and we're studying them more, and it's interesting. So if you really want to have double shuffle on A of tau, there is something that can be said. And my final remark, so this is a completely general remark, is what's beautiful about the fact that it can mold, untwist, symmetral, 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 is that, I think I said this already, but I want to stress it. So it's not just it goes from something a bit complicated to something simpler. It's that the simpler thing is a linearized version of the complicated thing. And that Yekalla's operator seems to always do this. You can use it in all these other contexts, like the Kashiwara-Verli algebra, the Goldenberg-Deichmann algebra, all different contexts. And you, when you have a double family of symmetries in the depth grade of the algebra, you apply this thing, it will change the symmetries, and it will give you back the symmetries of the associated graded. And I don't know why this is true, but it's something that seems to work in general. It's a very interesting principle. So I believe that in Yekalla's operator, there's a lot of stuff that still can be done and still can be explored.
Fancy terminology of Yekalla's, starting with Ari. What does Ari mean?
No.
I don't know why. Symmetrical and symmetrical.
I know that he has a whole system with vowels. Like now, A is like the Aleph, right? So everything that has no twists at all is A. So Simetral, Adamnal. A signifies that you haven't twisted by anything. But now he has completely new understanding of symmetrial, much more general, in which it's just one example of many ways of twisting symmetral. And so he has symmetrial, 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 symmetrial. And all the other vowels are twists of A. So, but I don't know the word Ari. I don't know. Okay. Why Ari?
Gary?
Ari. Gary is group. So that is typically, he'll add a G in front of everything to make it group-like, because Ari is the algebra situation.
So what's the group?
Gary is the
group.
Ari is on the algebra. Ari is on the algebra, so if you take this as a group.
The group should be the thing that you've made into a group by adding G. So what was it originally? The group.
The group.
A group? No, we don't use the word group. We only use the letter G. So Ari becomes Gary, the Ari bracket becomes the Gary multiplication, and push becomes gush. So if your word starts with a vowel, I'll just add a G. But if it starts with a consonant, you erase that consonant and put a G.
It started with a G.
So neg, for instance, which gives you the negative, becomes geg. And so, okay. But the thing is, sometimes you'll have an object. Ari, po, yiv, sumatra, yiv, elin. And it looks heavy in lots of little things, but everything is there, the whole information. You look at it, you know what you're looking at. It's a bit like when you go to Mannheim or Washington, D.C., and you look at the street, and this one is like C-17, and you need to go to L-81, and you know exactly where to go. You just know where to go. So it's a bit like, it's heavy notation, but it's incredibly informative. Instead of saying, you know, let A be the thing such that 20 properties, you just write them all there.
Yeah. If I took an arbitrary associator, an arbitrary elliptic associator, and looked at the coefficients, have you looked at these at kind of more general things?
I have not at all, but Enriquez has, but he. So the word arbitrary is interesting. He doesn't take only the one that I showed, but. The one that I showed comes deeply from phi kz, and he looks at all the ones that come only from phi kz. And he hasn't actually generalized that. He has studied and looked at different associators coming from phi kz, but they always give very similar stuff, because you're starting with phi kz. But no, you can very well do the general case, and he hasn't, and it's interesting.
So, no other questions for the moment? Then, let's thank Leila again and see you on Monday morning.